Good morning to everybody. Today we are having the lecture number two, remote sensing course. And this lecture number two is dealing with, as you can see in the title, electromagnetic radiation, radiometry and photometry. Before starting this second lecture, I want just to briefly summarize the first lecture. In the first lecture, you remember, in the first part, we talk about the characteristics of the course, materials, logistics, and especially final examinations. While in the second part, we go through the definition of remote sensing, mainly, highlighting also all the disciplines that together with remote sensing are part of geomatics. Then we introduce at the end of the second part of the first lesson a general schema that is related to a figure that you have in the lecture number one, related to the remote sensing process, in which we highlighted the different phase of this process that is dealing with the external source of electromagnetic energy, the point A, the point B, that is the interaction between electromagnetic energy and the atmosphere, point C, that is the interaction between electromagnetic energy and physical surface, especially on the ground. Then in point D, we have introduced the concept of detectors and sensors that usually are mounted on board of satellite platforms. Then we talk about, we introduce the concept of how to transmit the acquired data to stations, to ground stations on the Earth's surface. And then in point E and G, the photo interpretation process and the production of services and products that is mainly related with the general paradigm of this course, that is the most important things we mentioned in the first lecture, that is related to the possibility from the data acquired in a remote sensing process to extract valuable information. So now we are starting with the second lecture. And starting with the second lecture, we will begin the different topics, starting with the electromagnetic spectra. The transfer of electromagnetic energy occurs both with the properties of a wave and elementary corpuscles. According to the wave theory, radiant energy can be described as an harmonic wave that propagates in space and consists of two different orthogonal force fields. The electric field, that is called E, as you can see in the figures below, whose intensity varies continuously according to the direction of propagation X, and the magnetic field, that is called H, and you can see that in these figures. You see, in these figures, we have this direction, this axis, that is the X-axis, where the electromagnetic energy is propagating. This is the direction, this one that you can see on the pointer of my mouse. And then we have two different fields, the electric fields, this reddish one, and the magnetic field, this blue one. All right, and these two fields are characterized by an harmonic wave, you see here, that is propagates along the x direction, along the propagation direction. All right. And you see here that these harmonic waves propagated by means of this wave. All right. Let's go on. The wave is a model that lends itself well to represent and explaining the mechanisms of energy surface interaction on a macroscopic scale, and it is defined by three parameters. So we need three parameters, and we can describe this propagation model by harmonic waves using three different parameters. The first parameter is what is called lambda, this symbol here, that is called the wavelength. That is the distance that separates two consecutive peaks of the harmonic waves, and this wavelength lambda is measured with much smaller units than the usual ones, such as micrometers, this symbol here, that is microns. So the first way to characterize an electromagnetic energy is to measure the distance between two separate peaks of the harmonic waves, and this measure is called wavelength lambda, and this measure by the unit of measurement, that is the micron. The second way to measure an electromagnetic energy is by using the frequency V, this one, that is defined as the number of wave peaks that pass from a given point in a certain interval of time, that usually is a cycle per second, and which is usually expressed with the unit of measurement that is called Hz, Hz. So the second way to characterize this electromagnetic wave is using the frequency, the number of wave peaks, the number of oscillations that pass from a given point in a certain interval of time. The third way to characterize this electromagnetic energy is what is called A, that is the amplitude, which is equivalent to the height of each peak, and therefore to the maximum intensity of the electric fields E. It's expressed in terms of energy, such as the irradiance E, that is measured in watt divided by square meter and microns. Okay, we will talk about irradiance at the end of this lecture, but usually in the most part of the technical fields and in science where they are using electromagnetic energy, for example, think about telecommunication, for example, the smartphone, the cellular phone network, we are using frequency in order to characterize, for example, the electromagnetic energy that is carrying on the data, so our voice on the data. Instead, in remote sensing, we are using the wavelength lambda, and for us, so wavelength lambda is particularly important because of all the characterization of the electromagnetic fields and the electromagnetic energy is done by using this quantity lambda, usually measured especially for passive sensors in microns. All right, talking about the electromagnetic spectra, the transfer of electromagnetic energy occurs both with the properties, the product of wavelengths lambda and frequency V is constant and represents the wave propagation speeds. So that means that if you can easily calculate the velocity, the speed velocity, the propagation of the speed C, and this is equal of lambda times frequency, so wavelength times frequency, and this measure in meters divided seconds. All right, and C, you can have the information about what C is, that is the speed of light, that is approximately 300,000 kilometers per second. All right, the electromagnetic energy propagates according to transversal oscillations, as we can see in the figures, and the vector E, while remaining always perpendicular to the direction of propagation X, and to the vector H, can rotate around this axis in a continuous manner, then assuming any position in space. So, in these slides, there are two different concepts. The first concept is related to this equation, and this equation states that you can pass through lambda or V, so through wavelengths or frequency, in a very simple way. So if you have measurements in frequency, you can easily transform these measurement in frequency in wavelengths and vice versa. And the second thing is that according to the figures that we saw in the second slides, it's very important to establish the mutual position of the two different fields, the electric fields and the magnetic fields. Let's go on these things here. So, when an electromagnetic wave is transmitted within a precise plane of vibration, it is called polarized. So, what does it mean? That means, in other terms, that we can establish for every single electromagnetic energy a polarization of this electromagnetic energy. Considering that the two fields, the electric one and the magnetic one, are usually perpendicular to the direction at the X, that is the propagation direction, the polarization is something that is related, as I mentioned before, to the mutual position of the fields E and the fields H. Obviously, the polarization planes can be infinite. Of course, you can have infinite mutual position between the two fields, the electric one and the magnetic one. But in this particular configuration, where you can have infinite mutual position of these two fields, there are some positions that are different from the other. In fact, we can define three types of general position that turns out into three different polarization. The first one is what is called horizontal polarization. And this horizontal polarization occurs when the vector E is perpendicular to the plane of incident, defined by the incident ray, and the normal to the surface. What does it mean? That both the electric fields and the magnetic fields are perpendicular to the direction of propagation X, and they are mutually perpendicular. So that means that, as we mentioned and we saw in the figure before, these two fields that are perpendicular to each other are characterizing what is called horizontal polarization. The second possibility is a vertical polarization. When the vector that is containing the electric fields is in the same plane of the magnetic fields, that means that are complementary. So that means that with respect to the previous feature, in this case, the vertical polarization comprehends the two different fields, the electrical and the magnetic one, in the same plane. That means that polarization is considered vertical. The third kind of polarization is what is called random. A random polarization is a polarization that is the mutual position of the magnetic and electric fields that is randomly distributed. So that means that could have any possible position. And this position is changing over time. So that means that in a particular time t, you can calculate a random polarization by using the vector that is the resultant of the two different position of the two planes that are containing the two different fields, the magnetic and the electric fields. All right, just to mention this fact, you have to know, and this is the first information that I can give you, that is quite important right now, but it will become more important at the end of the course, that the sun, that is our external source of electromagnetic energy, is emitting energy with a random polarization. While when we are using active system, so we are using sensors that are able to produce their own electromagnetic energy, when we are producing electromagnetic energy, of course, we are producing electromagnetic energy that is polarized in one of these two first modes. So, or in horizontal polarization or in vertical polarization, because it's a synthetic emittance of electromagnetic energy. And it's much easier to measure, for example, the number of phases when you have, for example, an horizontal or a vertical polarization. Because if you have a random polarization, of course, it's much difficult to calculate, for example, the exact number of phases that passes for the same time. So I mean, just to know, the polarization is random for the energy that is emitted by the sun, and while the polarization is horizontal or vertical, when we are using active sensor. But why we are introducing this concept? This concept, as you can understand, is very important when we will talk about active sensors, so just at the end of the course. At the end of the course, I will remind you what we mentioned today, talking about polarization. But just to highlight the importance of the polarization, you have to know that some years ago, I mean at least one century ago, one of the first experimental tests that was done in United Kingdom was related to the facts that they were using an emitters of energy, a synthetic emitters of energy that is a spectrometer that was emitting energy, and this energy, this electromagnetic energy, were striking a very thin layer of water. And when they were emitting an horizontal polarization independently from the wavelength, the electromagnetic energy that was striking over this thin layer of water, if horizontally polarized, were in greater part absorbed by the water, but a very smaller part was reflected towards the sensor that was emitted this energy, towards the spectrometers. If using the same wavelengths, they were using the energy emitted in a vertically polarized mode, all the energy that was striking over this thin layer of water was completely absorbed. So that means that the polarization counts. That means that the different polarization can cause a different behavior of the surfaces that were struck by this electromagnetic energy. So just to know for you that the polarization is characterizing also, for example, the reflection modes of the different surface, we will face this problem, as mentioned before, only when we will talk about horizontally or vertically polarized signal. So only when talking about active sensors, just at the end of the course. So we can just have in mind that in this moment, because we are talking about electromagnetic spectra, but we keep that. We will keep this information because we will use that later on. So, talking about the electromagnetic spectrum, the polarization is a phenomenon of particular importance just because, as I mentioned before, it can be considered a diagnostic element in remote sensing. In fact, some natural elements such as water, leaf, catechol, atmospheric aerosol exert a specific polarizing action on solar irradiance. So that means that, for example, the aerosol that is in the atmosphere is behaving differently in comparison with the polarization of the energy that is striking over these particles. Finally, it is a technique, the polarization, that is widely used with the radar system. And I mentioned in the first lecture that the radar system, the radar, are the sensor, are the active sensor that are using remote sensing. And in radar system, we are using the polarization system in order to improve the diagnostic capacity of wavefronts reflected by the surface on which this electromagnetic energy affects. One of the main problems we have from the theoretical point of view is the representation of the electromagnetic spectra. The electromagnetic spectra is characterized by a continuous one-dimensional distribution of electromagnetic energy that is normally ordered for increasing wavelengths. So, since electromagnetic energy with null wavelength does not physically exist, of course, it cannot be said that the origin of the spectrum is with the value zero, but more realistically towards very small wavelengths. On the other hand, the electromagnetic spectrum ends for energy of infinite wavelengths that coincide with the continuous electric current. So, if we want to represent, and if we need to represent the electromagnetic spectra, and we should represent the electromagnetic spectra, otherwise we cannot understand each other, we are facing a couple of different problems. The first problem is that, of course, if we are characterizing the electromagnetic spectra by means of lambda, of wavelengths, the wavelengths are continuous from zero to infinite wavelengths, of course. And the second problem we are facing is that this kind of representation should be infinite because we have infinite wavelengths ranging from zero to very large lambda. So these two facts are very annoying from our point of view, and so we need to try to solve this problem. And how we can solve this problem? We solve this problem, so the facts that, first one, the electromagnetic spectrum is infinite, and the second is continuous, so we need to solve that in different manners. All right, here you can see the way in which we are solving the problem. So this is the figure. You see we can represent the electromagnetic spectrum like a monodimensional diagram. You see here in the upper of the figures, we have the representation of the ranging of wavelengths. From left side, very small wavelengths, and so very high frequency, to very large wavelengths. So that means very low frequency, all right? And here, we can represent that numerically. So you see here, we have a scale that is represented by the wavelengths, represented in this case with powers. All right, how we can solve the two above mentioned problems. How we can solve, for example, the first problem that is related to the infinite spectrum. So you can imagine that if the spectrum is infinite, I mean, I cannot stop this spectrum here or starting that from here because it makes no sense. I mean, this belt here and these wavelengths here should be infinite, so I cannot represent it. How we can solve this problem? Considering that that remote sensing is a very practical application. It is related to the facts that there are sensors on board of satellites, for example, that are able to acquire data coming from the ground. It is completely true that this can this sensor can acquire energy in every wavelength of the infinite spectrum. Well, this is not true, especially for very small wavelengths, because now we need to anticipate one of the topic of the interaction between the electromagnetic energy and the atmosphere. Because the Earth's atmosphere, especially the troposphere, so the atmospheric layer that is in contact with the Earth's surface, this layer, these atmospheric layers, has a very different transmission coefficient if compared with wavelengths that inside on that. So that means that, for example, the Earth's atmosphere is absorbing all the energy that is coming from the sun in very small wavelengths in the size. And thanks God this is happening, because I mean these wavelengths, such for example the cosmic or the X-ray, are very dangerous for human beings. So the Earth atmosphere is absorbing all this energy. And if it's absorbing all this energy and we have a sensor that is mounted on board the sensor that is outside these tropospheric layers, simply, this sensor is not able to acquire energy in these wavelengths that is reflected by the Earth's surface. Why that? Because from the sun, being the atmosphere completely absorptive, is absorbing all these kinds of energy, this energy is not striking over the Earth's surface. So if not striking over the surface is not reflecting any of this energy that is completely absorbed by the energy, by the atmosphere, and so is not going to the plane of the detectors of the sensor that is mounted on board the satellite. So it makes really no sense to have sensors that are sensitive in these very small wavelengths, because from the Earth we are not any energy that is coming from the Earth's surface. For larger wavelengths, I mean the sun, we will see later on, that is emitting in almost all the wavelengths. But you will see that, for example, for very long wavelengths, for example, in the radio band, the sun is emitting a very low quantity of energy, while on the ground surface, on the ground Earth, on the ground surface, we have artificial emitters, for example, all the antennas that are in charge for telecommunication, that are emitting much more energy on what in comparison with what with the amount of energy that is emitted from the sun. So the result is that if we have a sensor on satellites that is sensitive to the radio. To the radio bands in the electromagnetic spectrum, it will be able to acquire energy, but this energy is not the energy that is reflected by the Earth's being struck by the energy that was emitted in these wavelengths by the sun. But the results will be an image that is of data that are acquiring what is emitted by artificial antenna placed on the ground, that are emitting much more energy in comparison with the sun one. So the first problem, that is the infinity of the spectrum, could be solved for smaller wavelengths, considering that the atmosphere is absorbing most part of the very small wavelengths of energy that is emitted by the sun, and for longer wavelengths by the fact that what is emitted by artificial emitters is much more powerful than what is emitted by the sun. So at the end, if we are registering this energy, we are not registering this energy as reflected by the Earth, but as emitted by artificial source. So I mean, we are not characterizing our Earth system, but we are characterizing the artificial antenna. How we can solve the second problem? The second problem is that is the continuity of the spectrum, because from here you see you can understand that the wavelengths are strictly continuous over the electromagnetic spectrum, but we cannot use a continuity of the spectrum. The solution here is very formal and is very simple. How you can solve the continuity of the spectrum? Just partitioning the electromagnetic spectrum, this one you see here, in ranges of wavelengths, and giving to this range of wavelengths conventional names. So, for example, you see here you have gamma rays, here you have X-rays, here you have UV, ultraviolet. This part here that is very, very close, and you see is enlarged here from blue to red, is what is called visible, the part of the spectrum that where our eyes, the human eyes, are sensitive. Then you have the IR, that is the infrared. Then you have the microwaves, that is the part where radar systems that are active systems are working. And here you have radio waves. So I mean, you can partition all the spectrum in order to solve the continuity with ranges of wavelengths. These ranges of wavelengths are called spectral bands. Okay. Taking into account the distribution of energy as a function of wavelengths, the different mechanisms of interaction with surfaces, the characteristic of atmospheric transparency, and finally, instrumental design, the useful spectrum for a MOS sensing system can be conceptually divided into too many windows. So, what does it mean there? That means that taking into account how the energy is distributed by emission from the sun, and considering the sensitivity of the detectors, of the sensors that are mounted on board of the satellites, you can divide all your different spectra, I mean the different spectral bands, into two main windows. The first one is what is called optical windows, that is ranging from about 0.2 microns to 20 microns of wavelengths, where the energy that is involved is typically reflected or emitted energy in a natural way from the surfaces. And the second one is what is called the radar window, which is identified in the sub-centimeter interval between around 0.2 centimeters to 100 centimeters, that is 1 meter, of wavelengths, where the studied energy is usually activated artificially. So let's have a look at these two windows. These are two very important windows, especially this one. So this is the what is called the optical window. And you see here in the first column on the left side, we have the band and the conventional name of the band. And here you have the wavelengths interval. So that means that these are the name of the spectral bands. And this is the interval of wavelengths measured. So, starting with smaller wavelengths, the smaller wavelengths we can use in remote sensing, because there are specific sensors that are able to recall this kind of energy, is what is called ultraviolet. And the ultraviolet, please, you should remember that these wavelengths and this name by heart, because they are very important. The ultraviolet is ranging between 0.2 to 0.4 microns. The name ultraviolet you will see when we will approach the quantitative study of the colors is make no sense as name, but we will see that later on. The ultraviolet can be divided into two different subspectral bands that are not reported here, but I'm sure you know that. Because the path of the ultraviolet, this is ranging between 0.2 to 0.3, is called UVA, ultraviolet A, while the second subspectral bands of the ultraviolet, that is ranging from 0.3 to 0.4, is called UVB, ultraviolet B. I mean, these bands can be detected by sensor, but as you will understand, when we will introduce the interaction between the electromagnetic energy and the atmosphere, this is part of the electromagnetic spectrum that is very scattered by the atmosphere. So I mean, it's not so used in remote sensing, although there are sensors that are able to catch this quantity of energy. The second very important spectral band, at least for humans, is what is called VISIBLE. The acronym is VIS. The VISIBLE, the conventional name makes definitely sense because it's the range of wavelengths in which our eyes are sensitive. The VISIBLE is ranging from a very narrow wavelength interval that is ranging from 0.4 to 0.7 microns. And this visible spectral bands is partitioned into three different subspectral bands. What is called blue, that is ranging between 0.4 to 0.5 microns. What is called green, that is ranging between 0.5 and 0.6 microns. And what is called red, that is ranging between 0.6 to 0.7 microns. You see that the initial of these three subspectral bands, if you are reading that in the other position, red, green, and blue, the initial letters are RGB. And you are very familiar with the RGB because these subspectral bands, physically defined, are also something that is really related to the way in which our eyes, and for example, the screen that you are staring at listening to my lectures, are related when they are representing colors, because this is what we will learn in two or three different lectures is related to the colorimetric system. So I mean, they are very interested. After the visible, and the human eye is sensitive only to 0.4 to 0.7, as we mentioned before, after in wavelengths, these visible spectral bands, we have a very huge band in comparison with the other two that is called infrared. This conventional name infrared makes sense because it's beyond the red, so that's okay. And you see it's a very huge wavelength in comparison with the other two because it's ranging between 0.7 to 14 microns. And this infrared spectral bands is subdivided in three different subspectral bands. The first one, that is very important, especially because the vegetation is behaving in a very different way in these subspectral bands, is called near-infrared, and the acronym is NIR. It is ranging between 0.7 to 1.3 microns. Then we have what is called medium-infrared, and the acronym is MIR, that is ranging between 1.7 and 4.2 microns. And then we have the thermal infrared, the acronym is TIR, that is ranging between 8 to 14 microns. So three different infrared subspectral bands. You see there's no continuity here because, for example, from 4.2 to 8, there are no bands,
Why that? Because the atmosphere is absorbing all the energy. So there are no sensors mounted on board of satellites that are able, that are registering or they are recording and reflecting energy in, for example, for 4.2 to 8 microns, because I mean, being the atmosphere completely absorbed, it is absorbing all the energy coming from the sun, of course, the Earth's surface will not reflect anything because there are no energy that is striking over the surface. So it makes no sense, again, to mount a sensor on board of the satellite that are sensitive to this particular wavelengths. What we can say about this optical window that, and this is very important, from ultraviolet till to the medium infrared, the sensor are registering a reflectance that is coming from the ground. So they are registering the reflection of energy that was emitted by the sun, bypassed, that is bypassing the atmosphere, that is striking over the Earth's surface and is definitely and eventually reflected towards the sensor. Why? The sensors that are mounted on board of satellites, when they are registering thermal infrared, so energy that is ranging from 8 to 14 microns, they are registering emittance. So the energy that is emitted by the Earth's surface. So I mean reflection and emission, they are very two different natural behavior, and there are two different physical phenomena. And so we will need and we should in the future process, for example, the data that are recording reflectance in a different way in comparison with the data that are recording emission, so thermal infrared. So we will see later on how to process this data. This is the optical windows. Of course, we have also the other windows that is called the radar windows. And you see here we have three different columns: band, frequency, and wavelengths. Why frequency and not only wavelengths? Because for this kind of sensor, for example, radar sensor, that are active system, because the previous windows, the optical one, is characterized by, be used by a passive sensor. These radar windows is used only by radars, so by active system. And why does the frequency? Because these radar systems and in the sensor could be also characterized by their frequency of operation. So the frequency of the emission and the wavelengths of reception of the scattered by the target's signal. You see that the bands are ranging from Q, that is a wavelength that is ranging between 0.65 to 0.83 centimeters. So we have centimeter and not microns, so they are very long wavelengths, and then to K, X, C, S, L, P, and the P that is the larger wavelength is ranging between 30 to 100 centimeters. Why they have this strange name, these strange letters? Because I mean, the radar system was developed at the beginning of World War II for tactical problems in order to intercept aerial airplane flying enemies, plane flying over the channel, for example, by the British. And so, till the 70s of the last centuries, these different bands that were used by the sensor were encrypted in order not to give the opponents any information about the bands that were using. And so only in the 70s, the Western and the Eastern blocs agree on using this taxonomy. And so they use this particular name of the bands with this particular wavelengths. All right, let's go on, and let's talk about atmospheric window. I mentioned before that now we have to anticipate the topics that are related to the interaction between the electromagnetic energy and the atmosphere, and the first interaction is related to atmospheric windows. What are these atmospheric windows? Is something that is related with the atmospheric absorption. So the sun is emitting energy, but the atmosphere, in particular the troposphere, that is the atmospheric layers that is in contact with the Earth's surface, is absorbing part of the energy that was emitted by the sun. And the wavelength ranges in which the atmosphere is particularly transmissive due to radiant energy are called atmospheric windows. That means that all of the energy that was emitted by the sun, part of this energy is absorbed by the atmosphere, and part is transmitted by the atmosphere. So the atmospheric windows, as you can read here, is the part of the electromagnetic spectrum in which the atmosphere is represented by a very high transmissive coefficient. So that means that all the energy that was emitted by the sun and that is striking over the atmosphere in correspondence to the atmospheric windows is bypassing the atmosphere, is going to strike the Earth's surface, and this was and can be reflected towards the sensor that is mounted on board of the satellites. So that means that the atmospheric windows, these are the very first interaction with the atmosphere and are part of the atmospheric windows in which the sensors mounted on board of satellites are calibrated. All the sensors that are mounted on board the satellites are calibrated to work in the electromagnetic region where there are atmospheric windows. How we can understand that? We can understand by taking into account this first figure. This first figure is very important because it's the first figures of a long series that you will see in this lecture and in the following lectures, where we have a bidimensional diagram in which in the x-axis, as you can see here, and this is the very first of a very long series, we have the variation, the ranging of lambda measured in microns. So we will face many different diagrams in which on the x-axis we have wavelengths. What does it mean, these things here? This means, from a Laplacian point of view, that we are facing lambda as a variable. So that means that if we have all these bunch of diagrams where on the x-axis we have the ranging of lambda or wavelengths, that means that many of the things that are studying are considering wavelengths as a variable. So that means that the different physical effects are ranging in the wavelengths, so they are not constant in the wavelengths. And this is the first case, because this is the way in which, with the variation of lambda in the x-axis, is ranging what is reported in the y-axis. In the y-axis is reported the quantity of energy that is emitted by a body. All right, so you see that the energy that is emitted by the body is not a line that is parallel to the x-axis, so it's not constant, but has this function here, and here we have a very interesting diagram that is representing the way in which different bodies
at different temperatures, that is measured in Kelvin here, you see 6000 Kelvin, 3000 Kelvin, 1000 Kelvin, 300 Kelvin. So these are four different bodies that at that different temperatures are emitting a different quantity of energy if considering different wavelengths. What kind of body of this one? I mean, what we are interested in are the red curve and the blue curve. The red curve is the characterization of the sun that has a temperature approximately of 6000 degrees Kelvin and is emitting this kind of energy. While the blue curve is a representation of the emission of the Earth's surface that is in a mean value, has a temperature of 300 degrees Kelvin. So let's see how the sun is emitting energy. You see it's emitting energy in a very small wavelength, then have a peak. And you see here this color from blue, green, yellow, red. This is the visible, this belt here. So I mean the maximum of emission of the sun stands in the visible. And then you see with longer wavelengths, the sun is emitting a very poor quantity of energy. Here we have the radio bands, you see, is emitting very low energy. Well, this is the energy that is emitted by the Earth. You see, the Earth is not emitting in the visible, and this is quite clear, because if the energy is emitting in the visible, we should see that with our eyes, but we don't see any reddish plume or smoke coming out from the Earth. So, of course, it's not emitting in the visible, but you see it's emitting in the infrared, and in particular, you see is emitting with a peak in the thermal infrared. And you see here, the maximum is along longer wavelengths. So this is the way in which the two most important bodies we are considering, the red one, that is the sun, and the blue one, that is the Earth, is emitting energy. Then here is the representation of the atmospheric windows. You see, we have these two different diagrams. Again, on the x-axis, we have wavelengths. So I mean, as I mentioned before, atmospheric windows are a function of wavelengths. And here, you see, in the lower diagram, we have a percentage comprised between 0 and 100. And this is, on the y-axis, the quantity of absorbed energy. So you will see that all this grayish area, all these grayish peaks, are total absorption of the Earth. So I mean, you see, it's absorbing everything in smaller wavelengths and is absorbing in these peaks here, for example, in the middle of the mid-infrared. While all the whitish area are part of the electromagnetic spectrum in which the absorption is very low and in which is prevailing the transmission. So that means that all the energy that is striking over the atmosphere coming from the sun in these wavelengths is passing through the atmosphere and is going to the Earth's surface. And you see that here in the visible, there's a very big atmospheric windows. Why they are called atmospheric windows? Because they are related to the atmospheric behavior of windows, because it's like the glass of our windows. I mean, the windows are characterized by a very high transmissive coefficient in the visible in order to make the possibility to the visible to enter into our room by means of the windows. And this is the same things. And you see here in the diagram, in the upper diagram, that here you have the emission of the sun, you see, this is the red curve before, this is around 6000 degrees Kelvin, and you see here the peak of emission is in the visible, and you see here that we have in the blue curve the emission of the Earth. this shift of the thermal infrared. And you see that in the thermal infrared, around 10 microns here, we have a whitish area. That means that we have a atmospheric windows. White area are atmospheric windows. Grayish area are part of the electromagnetic spectrum in which the atmosphere is absorbed. Okay, now we need to talk about radiometry and photometry. I mean, this is a very, let's say, quite boring topics, especially when we will introduce all the different quantity. I want just to introduce the fact that we are very interested in the first two slides of these topics, and then you will have a description of the quantity that we are using. You don't need to learn all these equations by heart, but I mean you should know that they are existing, especially when we will talk about radiance and the irradiance, because they are two quantities in which we are very interested. So, talking about radiometry and photometry, that is the second big topics of this second lecture. Measurements of electromagnetic radiation emitted by the sun or the environment, or reflected by surfaces, or transmitted through a transparent surface, for example water, air, or even glass like in the windows, and acquired by the sensor, depends on four factors. So in order to understand how much energy could be collected by the detectors that are characterizing our sensor, we need to take into consideration four different factors. And these factors are very, very important. Which are the first factors? The first factor is what is called delta T, that is the time required to capture a finite amount of radiation, also called sensor integration time. The longer the integration time, the greater the amount of radiation collected. So I mean, in other terms, the integration time, delta T, is the time span that you need in order to acquire a certain amount of energy that is able to impress the detector of your sensor. So, for example, when we are using a digital camera, if we are in a very dark condition, we need much more time in order to acquire the quantity of energy that is enough to impress the sensor. While we have in a very sunny day outside, and there's very much energy that is coming from the sky, I mean, we need a very short time span in order to acquire the quantity of energy that is enough to impress the sensor. And of course, this is the first characteristics that we need to take in mind when we are talking about the amount of energy that is coming to our sensor. The second factor is related to the area that is called delta A of the surface portion framed by the sensor. The greater the size of the observed area, the greater the amount of radiation collected. So what that means? That means that if we are imaging a very small portion of surface, the quantity of energy that is reflected by this very small portion of area that we are framing could be not enough to impress the sensor. So the only way to impress the sensor is to enlarge the frame in which we are acquiring the image. This is very related if you are thinking about a digital camera or the digital camera that you have on board of your cellular phone, to the possibility to zoom in or zoom out the image when you are taking picture. When you are zooming in, you are framing a very small area, because you are zooming in a particular surface, and so the amount of energy that will reach the detectors of your digital camera will be reduced in comparison with the same picture when you are zooming out. So you are zooming on a larger area, and the larger area will reflect a larger quantity of electromagnetic energy, of course. The third factor is called the solid angle. Delta omega within the sensor collects the radiation, also called, and this is a very famous acronym in Cosensi, IFO, that stands for instantaneous field of view. The wider the angle, the greater the amount of radiation collected. This third factor is very similar to the second one. It is something that could be explained again with the zooming factor. When I'm zooming in, I'm reducing this solid angle. When I'm zooming out, so I'm enlarging the frame of my image, I'm enlarging this angle. So that means that having smaller omega angle, so that means that I will have a reduced quantity of energy that is going to the detectors of my sensor. While if I'm enlarging this angle, I will have in return more energy that will strike over the surface of the detectors of my sensor. The fourth factor that is very important is the spectral range of operation of the sensor, that is called delta lambda, that is also called spectral band. The wider the spectral bands, the greater the amount of radiation collected by the sensor. That could be easily understood if you are related, if the relation we can make is the relation, for example, with the table I presented before, for example, the optical windows. Of course, if I'm acquiring the same area with the same delta A with the same solid angle in the same integration time, having these three characteristics always the same, and if I'm acquiring an image over a surface with these three parameters, using, for example, only the blue band of the visitor of the visible spectrum, the energy that I'm collecting will be smaller than if I'm using the whole visible, so the blue plus the green and plus the red. Because I mean, I will acquire more energy, because more energy will be acquired, will be reflected and then acquired by the detectors of my sensors, if I'm enlarging the wavelengths, the range of wavelengths in which my sensor is operating. So it's very easy to understand. If I'm acquiring only on a very narrow range of wavelengths, the energy that I'm able to acquire will be smaller in comparison with with larger wavelength interval, of course. So these are the four different factors that are affecting the acquisition, the energy that could be acquired by detectors that is representing my sensor. And we will come back to these things here also in other lectures, because when I will explain to you the concept of resolution, in the different modalities is related to these different factors. These different factors can be used to represent the different quantity. Now I'm going really quick on this particular quantity. We have already 1 hour passed in this video. So we need to represent in two different systems this quantity. Why there are two systems? Because the radiometric system, the radiometry, is related to all the possible wavelengths of the spectrum that we know is infinite, of the electromagnetic spectra that we know is infinite, while photometry is only related to the visible part of the spectrum. So
The photometry is related to the measurements of quantity that are encompassing electromagnetic energy that is ranging from 0.4 to 0.7 microns. The visible. Okay, let's start with the radiometric quantities. And for radiometric quantities, the sparse quantity, that is the very elementary quantity, that is the radiant energy Q, that is the continuous and discrete quantities in which the wave packets called quantum are propagating in the space, could be represented by this quantity Q, that is H times V, where H is the Planck constant, and we know that H and V are already a quantity that we have observed before, and they are measured in Joule. But this is not a quantity that we are measuring in a remote sense. Then we have the radiant flux, in which it is called phi, as you see here, that is the amount of radiant energy Q transferred from the surface or point to another surface in the unit of time. So, considering the first factor, the integration time. So, the radiant flux could be represented by the variation of energy divided by the time in which the measurement is done. All right, and the radiant flux expresses the energy variation over time. Then we have the radiant intensity. What is the radiant intensity? Is the radiant that is named I, is the radiant flux phi outgoing from a source per unit of solid angle d omega according to a certain direction, and it is expressed in watts to the steradians. So I mean, we are integrating also another factors, that is the solid angle, and with the solid angle in unit of time, you are calculating the radial intensity I, that is d phi divided by the omega in watt to the steradians. Okay, and this is the representation, the graphical representation. So one single point is emitting energy in this cone that is measured here with this angle, that is the omega angle, and is emitted in this way. Radiant flux density. The radiant flux density is the ratio between the radiant flux, the previous flux, and the area of the surface involved, dA. So we are taking into consideration not only time, not only solid angle, but now we are considering the third factors, that is the dA, the area that is emitting energy or that is receiving energy. This radiant flux density measurement is quite important for us because, I mean, these measurements are used in remote sensing, and the radiant flux density could be divided into different quantities, what is called excitance and what is called irradiance. Excitance is indicated by the symbol M, and is expressed in this way. So M is the quantity of energy for unit of time for solid angle that is exiting in correspondence to a receiving area, dA, it is measured in watt for square meter. So the excitance is the energy that is exiting from a surface. But we can also calculate the irradiance that is represented by the symbol E, and is represented by this relation, that is E, that is the energy incident by solid angle, by unit of time, and by area to a specific area, and is measured again in watt for square meters, but this is energy that is incident. The excitance, as the terms state, is energy that is exiting from a surface. Irradiance is energy that is inside of a surface. And here,
you can have the representation, the graphical representation. So, for example, this is exitance, you see, energy that is exiting. And for example, in this way, we can characterize the way in which the sun is emitting energy. So, when we are calculating, and there are sensors on board of satellites that are continuously measuring the energy that is irradiated by the sun, so this sensor is measuring exitance. Why? This is the energy that is striking over the surface. For example, the energy that is striking over the Earth's surface coming from the sun. And so in this case, we are talking about, as we stated before, you see here, we are talking about irradiance. For example, irradiance is used as a quantity that is calculated over the Earth's surface in order to mount, for example, solar panel. We need to calculate the irradiance, that is the quantity of energy that is coming from the sun and it is inciting over a particular surface. So the irradiance values are calculated for all over the Earth's surface. All right, then we have the very last quantity, that is the radiance, that is the value that is represented with the letter L, that is the value of radiant flux, the phi for year, per unit of area dA, and solid angle d omega, according to a certain direction measured on a plane orthogonal to this direction. And this quality, I don't want you to learn that by Earth, that is calculated in watt divided square meters and still radians, is the quantity, is the measurements that is done by detectors of sensors that are mounted on board of satellites. I mean, and also our digital camera, they are acquired a value that is radians. So the quantity of energy that is reflected or emitted by a target towards the sensor and measured in a position that is, in a plane orthogonal to that direction, that is the plane that contains the detectors of our digital camera, for example. And if you want to have a representation of these things here, of course, here you can see that radiance appears to be the central and principal radiometric quantity of remote sensing. This is the representation. So there's a point that is emitting or reflecting energy in this solid angle, in this conical way, and we are measuring this energy here in a position where we have the plane of our detectors. I'm sorry, here is in Italian, this is the taken axis. All right, so on satellite, on sensor satellite, but also on the plane of our digital cameras, we are measuring radiance. All right, the radiance, okay, this is the same things as before, is repeated. All right, now we are going to photometric quantities. I mentioned before that the photometric quantities are related only to the visible part of the electromagnetic spectrum, so in a wavelength ranging between 0.4 to 0.7. And there are quantities that are different historically, and they were used times ago, but now, for example, in the illumination techniques, they are recalled, for example, for measuring the lamp's power, for example, LED power, they are using this photometric quantity because we are only interested in the emission of these lamps, for example, only the visible, of course. So we have the same quantity, but it is called in different way. So we are talking about elementary energy, that is the luminous energy, that is called Q, and as before, is the same quantity that is measured in LM, that stands for lumen for seconds. Then we have, as before, as radiometry, the luminous flux. that is the amount of luminous energy transferred from one point to another in a unit of time, so considering the factor delta t, that is this quantity here, so the amount of luminous energy for a time interval, and is measured again in lumen. Then we have the luminous intensity, that is the luminous flux that comes from a source per unit of solid angle in a certain direction, so that means that, is related to a solid angle, and this is measured in candles, CD, where a candle is equivalent to a lumen force radiant, pulse radiant. Lumen force radium. From an energy point of view, the candle is equivalent to one of divided 683 watt and corresponds to the intensity of monochromatic light emitted by the source of this frequency. So you see that they are using a very strange unit of measurements, in this case candles, but we can represent that again in lumen and then convert that in candles. This is the luminous energy. Then we have the luminous flux density that, as before, we can divide that, and this is the luminous flux divided by the area of the end of the intercepted surface, and is expressed in terms of lux, Lx, which is equivalent to one lumen for square meter, and as in the radiometry, the luminous flux density, it can be divided into different quantity, the luminous excitance, so the energy that is exiting, and the luminance, that is the energy that is striking over a surface. So, for example, we can calculate the energy that the sun is emitting only in the visible, and this quantity could be represented or by radiometric quantity, so the excitance, or by a photometric quantity, so the luminous excitance. If we want to calculate the quantity of the visible, of the energy in the visible, that is emitted by the sun and striking over the Earth's surface, we can of course calculate that with the irradiance in the radiometric system, but we can also calculate that in the photometric system with the illuminance. And you see here the two quantities as is the outgoing energy of the exiting energy and the incident energy, M and E, calculated both with the measurement units of lux. And then we have the luminance, and the luminance is the same things of the radiance. So the quantity of energy that a sensor can collect, a detector mounted on board of the sensor can collect, if we are talking about the radiometric system, it will be a radiance. If we are talking about a sensor that is only sensitive to the visible, for example, our eyes, our retina, we describe the working of the retina. The retina, for example, is sensitive to a luminance, to the quantity of energy in the visible that is striking over the retina itself. And it's calculated in candles, you see here. All right, so with that, we finish the lecture number 2. And we will meet again for the lecture number 3. Thank you very much.